palace's response made the monarchy look out of step with the public and the times. However cruel the banishing of Townsend, the hope was that a long separation would dampen Margaret's feelings, and that the romance would fade away and be forgotten. It was a plan that would spectacularly backfire. By banishing Townsend, the palace assumed that Margaret would see sense and go back to putting the duties of a royal before her personal feelings. But the plan went wrong. Margaret and Townsend wrote to each other every day for the entire year they were apart. Far from dampening the flames of their affection, their absence fanned them. A year after going to Brussels, Townsend flew back for a secret meeting using a false name to avoid the press. If they wanted to stop them now, the palace would have to find a new form of attack. It was time for Tommy Lascelles to spell out to Margaret the stakes she was playing with, and that if she went ahead, she would lose almost everything.
My father explained to her all the constitutional difficulties that would arise if she married a divorced person. And she was very grateful and wrote him a little note afterwards saying what a help it had been. Later on, as we know, she put a lot of blame on him for spoiling her relationship. I think that must have been an excuse for her unhappiness.
According to Lascelles, Margaret would have to give up her right to the succession, her title, and her royal income. But the British establishment was changing. When Churchill resigned, he was replaced by Britain's first ever divorced Prime Minister, Anthony Eden. Margaret knew that when she was 25, she would no longer need the Queen's permission to marry. And Eden was a potential ally. By the summer of 1955, Margaret's determination to marry was strengthening.
A few more weeks to my birthday and we'll both be free. You'll be free of the decision and I'll be free to make it.
There's nothing more you need to know.
Don't worry. Tommy did spell it out for me. Said I'd lose everything if I married Peter. I'll be Mrs. Townsend living in a rented flat. Doing my own washing.
Cooking Peter's bloody supper. But I'll not be told what to do by him. I'm sure he was just trying to help. Show you what you might lose.
In fact, I've written to the Prime Minister.
Oh, yes.
Sir Anthony seems a good sort. For a married divorcee. I want to keep him abreast of what has happened. So that if the time comes, he will not be against us.
What will you say?
That I'm going to wait till October. When Peter's in London.
I've been missing him so much, Lilith, that you can't imagine. I just need to see him one more time. To be totally sure.
In an extraordinary letter that has been unearthed in researching this film, Margaret wrote to Eden, asserting and clearly believing that the most important decision in her life was hers, and hers alone to make.
My dear Prime Minister, during the last of August and all of September, I shall be here at Balmoral. And I have no doubt that during this time, especially on my birthday, on August 21st, the press will encourage every sort of speculation about the possibility of my marrying Group Captain Peter Townsend. In October, I shall be returning to London. And he will then be taking his annual leave. I do certainly hope to see him while he is there, although I well know this will provoke the press to still further inquiries and guesses. But it is only in seeing him in this way that I feel I can properly decide whether I can marry him or not. At the end of October or early November, I very much hope to be in a position to tell you what I intend to do. Yours very sincerely, Margaret.
It's a remarkable document. This isn't just Princess Margaret being told, well, you've got to make the decision. This is somebody who's actually saying, I'm going to decide what's going to happen here. And I will tell you what I've decided.
On Sunday, the 21st of August, Margaret turned 25. She was free by law to decide, and the nation waited for an answer. As the pressure mounted for a decision, the Queen invited Eden to Balmoral. In an intriguing detail from Eden's diary, it's clear that out of many topics on the agenda, Margaret was top of the list. The Queen must still have believed that Margaret had to choose between Townsend and all the royal privileges. But the Prime Minister had a bombshell for her.
Sir Anthony, I'd be grateful if you would speak to my sister. Would you kindly inform her of all the obstacles that lie in her path?
Certainly, ma'am. Although, perhaps there aren't as many as you may think.
Oh?
The lawyers have been at work. If the princess wishes to marry, she may simply have to renounce her claim of succession to the throne.
And all her royal privileges?
No, ma'am. Nothing more.
This changed everything. Spurred by growing public support of Margaret's marriage, Eden had helped find a loophole. If Margaret married, all she would have to give up would be the slim prospect of becoming queen herself. But all the other barriers were taken away. Nothing need stop her now.
Group Captain Peter Woolridge Townsend, CVO, DSO, DFC and Bar, mentioned in dispatches former equerry to Her Majesty. But he is also the man the world has been talking about more and more over the past 2 years. Seldom can a man have been so widely discussed without being able to say a word for himself.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Your princess has asked if she may see you.
You know, I was just about to go for a walk. Would you tell her that I'm out, but I'll be back very soon?
Very good, ma'am.
Townsend was about to arrive back in the country, and Margaret was free now to meet him and announce her engagement. She no longer needed the Queen's formal approval, but she still wanted something that was equally important. Her sister's blessing. But the Queen avoided her.
Is the Queen still out walking?
Yes, ma'am.
Without speaking to her sister, Margaret left for London and the long-awaited reunion with Peter. But the Queen couldn't stall for much longer. October the 12th, Townsend flew back into Britain. And this time, he was confident enough to brave the glare of the world's media. Later that day, Margaret arrived in London too. The first time they had both been officially together in the city for 2 years. The world's media went into a frenzy.
Princess Margaret and Group Captain Peter Townsend are two important weekend guests at Allen Bay Park near Windsor. Pressmen and sightseers throng the lanes, undeterred by the official statement that no announcement is contemplated at present about the princess's future. Only a brief glimpse is caught of the royal visitor as her car hurries by.
Blasted flashbulb, nearly blinded me. No, I have nothing to say, nothing to say. I swear I'm saying it in my sleep. They're supposed to be on our side. Can you believe this? Queen's press secretary announces that no announcement is at present contemplated. A no announcement announcement, only from the palace.
Peter, shut up! Sorry.
No. No, I'm sorry.
The palace called.
You've spoken to the Queen.
They want me to go to Windsor at the weekend. On my own.
Although daunted by the prospect of meeting her sister, Margaret knew she was in reach of achieving her impossible dream. As she returned to Clarence House, it is now clear that the government were fully prepared for a marriage. Independently, they drew up a statement for the princess to tell the world.
After careful thought, I have come to the conclusion that it is necessary to my future happiness that I should marry Peter Townsend. At the same time, I recognize that I should give up my rights to the succession both for myself and for my descendants.
Peter Townsend was powerless, pursued by the world's press, as the two sisters prepared for the most important meeting of their lives. The waiting couldn't last any longer. On Friday, October the 21st, the Queen and the Princess attended the unveiling of a statue of King George VI.
He never wavered in his faith that with God's help, the cause of freedom would prevail.
The Queen knew that nothing stood between Margaret and her future happiness. Nothing except herself. On the Saturday evening, Margaret travelled up to Windsor to join the Queen, Prince Philip and the Queen Mother. By the end of the weekend, the decision would be made.
It's almost certain that this was make your mind up time. This was crunch time.
She must have been deeply upset for her sister. In fact, I know she was deeply upset that her sister had to go through. But I'm sure also that in her own mind, the Queen's mind, she knew that the right course.
On Sunday, October the 23rd, after church, the Queen finally faced the meeting with her sister that she had dreaded.
Should we take some air, Margaret?
Of course.
If that is what you would like. The world's gone mad. I've been so frightened. Well, you're safe here. No photographers. Poor thing, you've been besieged.
I've wanted to see you. To talk to you for so long.
You've got so many friends. Newspaper editors. Even the Prime Minister.
I feel so alone.
What about Peter?
Peter's been very supportive.
It is what you want, isn't it, Margaret? Well, you can have it now.
Isn't it enough to want to be happy?
Do you really think we are so free to put our own happiness first? People look to us, Margaret, to our family, to reflect what is noble in themselves. And what matters most? Is it how we dress? Where we live? Or is it how we behave?
Lilibet!
You may keep the appearance of royalty, Margaret. But if you do this, will the substance of who we are, who you really are, ever be the same?
I never wanted to go against your wishes, Lilibet. I never wanted to defy you.
You never have. But this is not my decision now. It is yours.
Leaving Windsor, the course of Margaret's future life was determined. Her decision had been made, and she was ready to announce it to the waiting world.